Hi guys, I'm Prateek Singh, and in this video, we're going to discuss single candlestick patterns. The first one we're going to talk about is the marobozu. Now, the word marobozu in Japanese actually means bald. It basically means a candlestick which doesn't have any upper shadow or lower shadow. So let me show you what that looks like. So bullish marobozu looks something like this. You have a candlestick which is just moved up. Obviously, it's bullish. It has no upper shadow or any lower shadow. And a bearish marobozu looks just like this. In fact, the textbook definition of marobozu is that the open is equal to the low, it's right here, and the close is equal to the high for a bullish marobozu. And for a bearish marobozu, the open is equal to the high and the close is equal to the low. Now, textbook definitions aside, in the real world, you may get a little bit of a shadow, and I'll actually draw that here. You may have a little bit of a shadow. It could even be on either side, and that's completely fine. The reason could be, one, you shouldn't read too much into each candlestick by finding out what the textbook definition is. The second reason that the closing prices are an adjusted weighted average of some period of time. So for example, on the daily chart, the adjusted close is the last 30 minutes average. So because of these intricacies, you may get a little bit of a shadow, but the truth is, whether you have this little shadow or not, this is a very bearish day, assuming this is on a daily chart, and the psychology remains exactly the same. It can actually appear anywhere on the chart, and the definition and the implication is always the same. In an uptrend, if a bullish marobozu appears, it means that the trend has gone stronger towards the upside. In a downtrend, if a bearish marobozu appears, it means that the trend is strong towards the downside. Now, the opposite is also true. In a downtrend, if you get a bullish marobozu, it may mean that the trend is reversing. And in an uptrend, if you get a bearish marobozu, it may mean that the uptrend is now reversing to a downtrend. Or an uptrend may reverse to a downtrend because of all the selling pressure. So let's take a minute to understand the psychology behind the marobozu. It's very simple. As soon as the market opened, the first trade of the day marked actually the low of the day, which means that after that first trade, the market never went lower than that. Now we all know that the market follows an auction system, which means people can bid for lower amounts, can offer lower prices, but that trade never happened. The price continued to go up because the buyers were overpowering the sellers and the price continued to be bid upwards. Now, this demand is very evident at the open of the day, but it continued throughout the day and you can see that the market actually went up. And even towards the close, the buyers were still in control. And even at 3:30, the highest point of the day was your close. And that means that the market continued to have demand throughout the day. So this means that this was an extremely bullish day right from the start of the market till the end of the market. So let's see an example of a bullish marobozu in action. I have Bajaj Finserv over here on a daily chart. And you can see 22nd July has this perfect marobozu. It has a very small upper shadow, but that's completely fine. As you can see, the market opened and that was the low of the day, and it's closed almost at the high of the day, where closed is almost equal to the high, which means we have this pattern right here, the bullish marobozu. And let's see this a little more closely. I'll open, say, a 5-minute chart and see what this looks like. And I'll scroll back. So this is the intraday chart. So you see this long green bar here? This is where Bajaj Finserv actually started on 22nd. The open of the day was here and the market straight away went up, which clearly means that as soon as the market opened, there was demand and the market shot up immediately in the first 5 minutes. That's how the open is equal to the low. And then you can see there was some movement down. It continued to move up. And notice, this is where the market closes, right here. Can you see this? this is the close of the day. Don't see this bar because that's the next day. Ignore that. Look at this small green bar. That's the close of the day. It's closing very close to the high, which means the market opened at its low, continued to move out throughout the day, and closed almost close to its high. That, very simply, is a bullish Marabuzo. So now we're going to talk about the paper umbrella. It's called the paper umbrella because, well, it looks like an umbrella. You have a small, real body, and then you have a long, lower wick, which should be about 2x or more of the real body itself. This is called the body-to-wick ratio. Now, the paper umbrella's name actually changes when it appears in an uptrend or a downtrend. So when you see this formation in a downtrend, it's called a hammer. And when you see this formation in an uptrend, it's called a hanging man. Let me show you what this looks like. So it has a small real body and it has a long wick. The lower shadow should be at least 2x of the real body itself. And the hanging man, like I said, is only in a context of an uptrend. So you want the previous trend to be up, and the expectation of the hanging man and the hammer is that it's a reversal pattern. That's right, it's a reversal pattern. So when you see a hanging man in an uptrend, the expectation of a trader that the trend is going to reverse at that point. Now, since the hanging man and hammer are reversal patterns, in an uptrend, when a hanging man appears, the expectation is that a downtrend may begin. And when a hammer appears in a downtrend, traditionally, it's expected that the trend will reverse. So this is what the hammer looks like. Small real body, and you have a longer wick. So the prior trend is actually down. And the expectation in this case is that the trend will reverse. So before we look at actual charts, let's just understand the psychology over here. I'm going to explain the psychology using the hammer because I think you'll find it very intuitive and it's just easier to understand. So imagine the market is following this downtrend. Now remember, in a downtrend, there are buyers as well, but the overall movement over a long period is down, right? So the bears are in control. Now at this point, the bears continue to be in control and the market is pushed downwards, creating this lower wick. At that point, somehow, after that, the bulls come in, I'll mark this with the blue, and push the market up. That means the bulls have to overpower the bears by absorbing their supply, then giving a net buy, bidding the market upwards, creating this bullish movement, and thereby creating a hammer. Now, this makes sense, right? That there was so much selling pressure, despite that, for some reason, remember, we don't ask why in technical analysis, we just discuss what. The bulls were able to overpower the bears and push the market upwards, creating a hammer. So obviously, the next logical conclusion is that the market should move up from there, and hence it's a reversal pattern. So I'll show you one example on Bank Nifty. This is obviously the index and the spot prices, not futures. I've opened the daily chart and we can see that Bank Nifty was moving down. And as it nears this low, we can see that a nice hammer has formed. Let me zoom in a little bit. Can you see that? So the movement was very simple. The market fell, tried to go up, came back down and created this hammer right here. And after this hammer, the market actually moved up. Another hammer formed and then it moved up from there. And in this case, the market, the trend actually reversed. We've already discussed the psychology behind why this might have happened. But the beauty here is, guys, remember that the psychology of the market participants is more important than the names or how it looks or whether there's a 2% ROIC or there's a 2x ratio. Just remember that if the psychology is imprinted on price action, that's the core that you need to understand. And I hope that this makes sense. Again, if you have any questions or want some nice discussions around this, go to Varsity, check out the post, talk about it in the comments. They've already had a lot of discussion around this, and I'm sure this will really help. So now the question is, you've understood hangman, you've understood hammer, we talked about the trend context, we even showed one example. How do you see this from the perspective of a trader? So I'll give you an idea from a traditional aspect, from a traditional viewpoint, how do traders view a hammer? Very simply, if you look at the Bank Nifty example, the moment this bar closes, this is a hammer. The next day opens, we say, okay, the hammer has been formed. Now, as the market moves upwards, we can see that the trend is reversing. The question is, where do you make a buying decision? You would obviously make a buying decision above the hammer, that as the hammer high crosses, you can say that you have some sort of confirmation buying demand is happening. And if you're using only the hammer to make a buying decision, then that is an area where you'll create a system and that is where you'll make your decision. At what point does the hammer fail is the next question. So at the low of the hammer, as soon as price crosses the low of the hammer, we can say that the hammer itself has failed and the pattern is not working. So if you look at this day, 2 days after the hammer was formed, the market actually went, it was probably 10% of the hammer size away from touching the low. It didn't touch the low, it just went up and price reversed. So in this case, if the market had gone below the low of the hammer, we would have said that the hammer just isn't working in this case. So that's how you see this from a trader perspective. Whatever we discuss for hammer is exactly the same for hanging man. So from a trade perspective, if the market crosses the low of the hanging man in an uptrend, we know that a trend reversal may be in order. And if the market crosses the high of the hanging man, we know that that's an area where the hanging man has failed and the trend will seem to continue to move upwards. So these are the two things, hanging man and hammer. They look exactly the same. The trend context is a little different. Now we're going to talk about the shooting star. If you understood the hammer really well, you'll really understand the shooting star extremely well because they're both really similar. So the hammer inverted is what the shooting star is. Just like the hammer was bullish in a downtrend, the shooting star is bearish in an uptrend. And you'll understand this quite intuitively. Imagine the market moving upwards, and I'll draw the shooting star with the red because it's a reversal pattern. And you have a small real body and you'll have a long upper wick. And the expectation is that the trend will reverse here on or is likely to reverse here on. So traditionally, just like the paper umbrella pattern, this has to be a small body. Ideally, there should be no lower wick, but even if you have a small lower wick, something like that, it's completely fine. And you have a long upper wick, the longer the better. So imagine if this was a really short upper wick, it's not as powerful as this, which is much, much longer. So let's understand the psychology behind this. The market has been moving up, the bulls are in control, pushing price upwards. Then the market opens and the bull run continues, giving us, I'll mark it with the blue, giving us this upper wick, right? And the bulls are pushing market up as expected because we are in an uptrend. However, at this point, the market reverses and falls and the bears become in control. Now for the bears to become in control, they would have to first overpower the bulls, which were in control for a period of time, create more supply than demand, continue to push markets throughout the day downwards, and end as the winner for that day or for that period of the candle. Ideally, if this is a red candle, it makes it slightly more powerful, but the color of the candle doesn't matter as much. What matters is that there was a huge up move in that day. The bears overpowered the bulls, pushing markets down. And as I said before, the expectation is that the markets reverse downwards. The example I have is PEL, Piramal Enterprises, and this is a daily chart. As we can see, the market was moving up, and this is a really strong bull market, right? We went from 1600 and made a high of almost 2500. So it's a pretty big bull market. Now, at this point, I can see two shooting stars, right? This one, but let's focus on this shooting star right here. It has a small lower wick, which is completely fine. It has a long upper wick, which is great. Which means the bulls were trying to move the market up, but the bears overpowered. And it means that a sell-off has started. And as you can see, we had a few dojis here, and we've discussed this, that this doji means that there is indecision, and then the market's actually reversed from there. Very simply, that is what a shooting star looks like. You get it in an uptrend, you expect the market to reverse. Now, as a trader, what should your perspective be? Traditionally, you want some sort of confirmation. So as soon as this shooting star happens, if markets go below the low of that candle, you know that a downtrend may be in effect, so you could make a selling decision somewhere there. If the markets reverse and cross the high of the shooting star here, at that point, you'll say that the shooting star has failed. This candle psychology is not in effect for that trend. And that's what failure means for the shooting star. So I think we covered a lot in this one video, right? Not only did we start with a few candlesticks, we showed a bunch of examples, the psychology. And like I said, if you have more things to discuss, head on to the Varsity Post, put in your questions and people will answer. There are already a lot of useful discussions there, so I'd urge you to check that out. That brings us to the end for the single candlestick patterns. But you know, sometimes a pair or multiple candlesticks comes into effect. That's what we're going to learn in the next video, of how multiple candlesticks can actually form a formation and give us an insight into the psychology of the market. Key takeaways from this video are: